In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Well, good morning to you all, and welcome to St. Fagans today on this second Sunday of Easter. Today's Gospel tells of how, having seen Jesus in person, the disciples are convinced of the resurrection. We too meet him personally today as we gather to celebrate the Eucharist. So let us pray that we might be filled with a faith in him so strong that we cannot wait to tell others about it. We also offer our Mass today in thanksgiving for the life of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. And we pray for the Queen, members of the royal family, and for the repose of his soul. Father of glory, holy and eternal, look upon us now in power and mercy. May your strength overcome our weakness, your radiance transform our blindness, and your Spirit draw us to that love shown and offered to us by your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. My friends, as we gather together as God's family around God's table, let us in a moment of silence call to mind our sins and failings, sure in the knowledge that God is always ready to help us and forgive us. Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what we ought to have done. We are sorry and truly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us in his way to walk as children of light. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you and set you free from sin. Strengthen you in goodness and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty Father, you have given your only Son to die for our sins and to rise again for our justification. Grant us so to put away the leaven of malice and wickedness, that we may always serve you in pureness of living and truth, through the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them, and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And we say the psalm all together. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. A reading from the first letter of John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you. Listen to the Gospel of Christ according to St. John. It was evening on the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This July, I will have been ordained for 20 years. A quite unbelievable statistic. I know what you're thinking, yes, he doesn't look anywhere near old enough. Maybe not. One of the many joys over those 20 years has been to get to know, to work with, and share important times with hundreds of wonderful people in the various parishes where I've served. Now, as we all know, people come in all shapes and sizes, in all different temperaments and outlooks. And this is what makes life so fascinating. And I often joke that the same people turn up time and again in different parishes. So Mrs. X from Parish A reminds me so much of Mr. Y from Parish B, and so on. And in every parish that I've served in, there has always been at least one blunt speaker. The person who doesn't hold back, but says precisely what they think. Now, I was going to tell you who the blunt speakers are in this parish, but I want to be here for a few more years yet, so I will keep that to myself. Now, sometimes such a person can be quite exasperating, as their bluntness may come across as rudeness. But often, you know, I have more than a sneaking admiration for the blunt speaker, because at least you know where you stand. You always know that they're being honest, not saying what they think you want to hear. And also, there's part of me that wishes I had the courage to be as forthright as them sometimes. Well, it's uncanny that the gospel reading set for today and the news of recent days have both reminded us of two blunt speakers. Our gospel for today, which is set every year on the Sunday after Easter, tells the story of Thomas. Strangely absent the first time the risen Jesus appears to the disciples, he's later told this amazing news by the others. And Thomas's response is maybe not what the other disciples expected. Thomas didn't say, "Wow, that's amazing, what fantastic news." Possibly a bit miffed that he missed out on the experience. He's quite blunt. It's not even, "Unless I see for myself, I won't believe." He says he actually wants to touch Jesus' wounds to make sure. And I can imagine the other disciples didn't take this too well. After all, he was in effect doubting their word. Yet Thomas clearly had a pragmatic sort of mind. He wouldn't just accept what he was told at face value. He wanted hard evidence, and wasn't afraid to say so. And if the others were upset by that, then so be it. Well, that's Thomas. And of course, on Friday, we had the sad news of the passing of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. Over his many decades of public service, which we rightly give thanks for today, he gained a reputation as something of a blunt speaker. He often said exactly what was on his mind, even if it wasn't always the most tactful thing. It was as though he sought to cut through the often stifling royal protocol and try and lighten the mood. Maybe he said some of the things that the Queen was dying to, but didn't. And yet, like Thomas, we know that Prince Philip had an inquiring mind, never willing to accept the most obvious explanation for something. A very well-read man in areas such as history, philosophy and theology, he was also fascinated by design, technology and innovation. Well, Thomas, of course, is often nicknamed the Doubter, Doubting Thomas. But that label, if you like, overlooks the fact that a week later, as we heard, he declares Jesus to be my Lord and my God. When Thomas comes face to face with Jesus, he accepts the truth that Jesus is risen. And if Jesus has risen from the dead, this can mean only one thing, that Jesus truly is the Son of God, because mere mortals don't reappear with their friends after death. And this, I think, is Thomas's logical mind at work again, but this time it leads him to full faith. And just as interesting as Thomas's reaction to meeting Jesus is how the Lord treats Thomas in that meeting. Notice that Jesus doesn't tell Thomas off for his blunt speaking from the week before. In fact, it's almost as though Jesus appreciates the fact that Thomas spoke his mind. And Jesus encourages Thomas to do what he wanted to do, to touch the wounds. In the end, of course, it wasn't necessary. As always, Jesus meets us where we are, with our questions, with our doubts, and gently encourages us to work through them. Church tradition tells us that sometime after the events recounted today, Thomas went to India, where he was instrumental in spreading the Christian faith. And ultimately, we're told he gave his life for his faith in Jesus. So Thomas, the pragmatic man, the man with questions, accepted Jesus as Lord, and then dedicated the rest of his life to serving him. In a similar way, Prince Philip accepted the role that history had dealt him, the role of always being one step behind his wife, and he dedicated his whole life to serving her and this nation. The Queen has described him as her strength and stay, and I'm sure that his no-nonsense, straightforward attitude has been a huge benefit to her, surrounded as she is by so much protocol and deference. Both Thomas and Prince Philip, it seems to me, stand as worthy examples to us today. They're examples of people who used their intellect and their reason, people who are not afraid to question or challenge things that didn't make sense. They both wanted to get to the heart of the matter, but when it really mattered, they both accepted and they both served without fail. Each in their own way, we salute them and give thanks for them today. It's been said many times that the past year has been a time of great loss for so many people. Today, the royal family is also experiencing what so many of us have gone through these past 12 months. And yet, there's another fitting piece of timing to the events of recent days. In 2002, just 1 year after I was ordained, the Queen Mother died the day before Easter. This year, Prince Philip died on the Friday after Easter. And it's Easter that gives us hope in the midst of so much difficulty. It's the sight of the risen Lord greeting his friends and saying, "Peace be with you," breathing on them and imparting the gift of his Spirit. But crucially, as the story of Thomas reminds us, it is the risen Lord who still bears those wounds of the cross on his body. So Easter doesn't wipe away the pain and the loss, but offers us a way through it. Today, the risen Jesus greets us and all who mourn or suffer and promises to walk alongside us. It's through trusting and believing in him that, as the Gospel writer John puts it, we may have life in his name. Amen. And so we stand to say the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Gweddion, let us pray. So now we come to that moment where those watching at home on our live stream are invited to put in any prayer requests you'd like included in our intercessions in the comments. As always, please don't mention anybody by name unless you have their permission to do so. Lord Jesus, you announced peace to your disciples. Breathe into your church the gift of your Holy Spirit. Give faith for doubt and boldness to fainting hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you announce peace to your world. Breathe upon the nations a desire for harmony and concord. Strengthen the fearful and all who seek to reconcile places of conflict. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you announce peace to our communities. Breathe upon our common life your generosity. In your grace, open our hearts to share of our riches and poverty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you announce peace to injured and battered peoples. Breathe upon all in special need your healing presence. Anoint us all in your great goodness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you announce peace in the face of death. Breathe upon all who have died your life and forgiveness. Bring light to the darkness of death and rejoicing to the place of tears. And we remember before you all those who have gone before us, especially all those who have been dear to us. And among the recently departed, we pray particularly for Prince Philip and Barry Samuel, and also for those whose anniversary of death occurs at this time, especially Albert Williams, Alan Maddox, Gareth Roberts, Frederick Harris, and Elias Morris. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And so we join our prayers with those watching us online. A prayer request here. Please pray for my family member who needs courage and to know his own self-worth at a tough time in his life. We're asked to give thanks for the continued health of my niece and her husband. Please pray for my dear friend that chemotherapy will be successful this time, and for all children, parents and grandparents as school returns. We're asked to pray for a person's father who will be having an operation very soon. Please pray for my daughter. A prayer here, Lord, let your hands be the surgeon's hands who will be operating on my sister-in-law. Cast out her cancer and let your healing manifest itself in her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The risen Jesus came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the Lord. Tang nefedd yr arglwydd afogad ych chi bob amser. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. And all be pleased to accept the sacrifice we offer you with humble and contrite hearts. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. He is the true Paschal Lamb who was offered for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his resurrection he has restored to us eternal life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hear us, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Through him accept our sacrifice of praise, and grant that by the power of your Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be for us his body and his blood. Who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come in glory. Therefore, Father, remembering the saving death and resurrection of your Son, we offer to you in thanksgiving this bread and this cup, your gifts to us, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send your Holy Spirit upon all of us who share this bread and this cup. Strengthen our faith, make us one, and welcome us and all your people into the glorious kingdom of your Son. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, for we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. Grant that these gifts of your body and blood may cleanse me from my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful always to your teaching, and let me never be parted from you. Amen. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. The body of Christ. Amen. The blood of Christ. Amen. Thank you. So just like to draw your attention to the notices on the newsletter. We've got a few Zoom events coming up. We're all quite familiar with Zoom events now, although I'm sure we'd all like to get back to face-to-face, but still, needs must. So next Sunday we have our youth service, which we're trying to do sort of about every other month. That's at 6 p.m. The following evening we have one of our quiz nights again, which we're trying to do every so often. That's at 7:30. And then the Sunday after that is our annual parish vestry, which is, if you like, the annual meeting, the AGM, if you like, of the parish, where we present all the reports, the accounts and so on, review the year. Not that much has happened in the last year, but still, I'm sure we can think of something to say. Normally, as always, we gather together after evensong on a Sunday, but we can't do that. So again, the annual vestry will be on Zoom, beginning at 6:30. So if you'd like to come to any or all of those, please drop me an email or mention it to me and I will send you the necessary details. Now, it's spring is in the air, so the St. Fagans Working Party is starting again, which we try and do on a Monday evening to look after the grounds and any jobs that need doing in and around the church. Everyone's welcome, regardless of ability. So that's at 6 o'clock. If you can come along, of course, it's the ideal, as I said, social distance activity, because you can be a long, long way from anybody else if you want to be. So if you can come along and help, that will be much appreciated. Finally, some congratulations to Yvonne Williams, whose birthday was yesterday. Yesterday, by the way, was also the 100th day of 2021. That's a useless piece of information for you. Only 265 days to go. We say happy birthday to Isaac Barry, who is going to be 11 on Tuesday. Aaron Harris, who has a birthday on Thursday. Kim's here, you can pass on our congratulations. Emily Lewis, who will be 19 on the 16th. Quite a good thing now, I've been doing this for over a year, so I can just look back to last year's newsletter and see where the birthdays come. I've given away my secret there. We've got an extra one, which is Eva was 1 on Friday last, the 10th. Wasn't that the 9th? Friday? Yesterday was the 10th. Anyway, she was 1 at some point in the last few days. Another lockdown baby. So we wish her all the best on her first birthday as well. Any other birthdays we've missed? No? In that case, do take the newsletter home with you. Keep it somewhere handy. Use it in your prayers, etc. during the week. And as always, if you could remain in your places at the end of the service, wait to be dismissed. But I shouldn't say this, our blunt-speaking church wardens. There we are. I said it now. Never mind. We love you both. We love you both. They'll tell you where to go, literally. I should stop now, stop digging. As Prince Philip said, what was it? Dontopodology was the art of putting your foot in your mouth, which I'm quite good at as well. Anyway, let us stand now for our concluding prayers. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious. Lord God our Father, through our Saviour Jesus Christ, you have assured your children of eternal life, and in baptism have made us one with him. Deliver us from the death of sin, and raise us to new life in your love, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you. God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you to walk with him in his risen life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ, amen. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.